Okay, hello everybody. My name is Martijn Boogaert. I am a senior security analyst at a company called Whisker from the Netherlands. And we are specialized in embedded device security. And as part of my work, I spend a lot of time looking at real-time operating systems, trusted operating systems, and similar systems. And one of the things I did is I did some work on being able to fuzz trusted operating systems. And before I would start with the real presentation, I would like to show you something. The reason why we are here. So what I have running here at the top. Oh. I am apparently fuzzing the cable as well. Any idea why? Okay, the other connection seems to work fine. So what we have here is AFL, the widely known, widely used fuzzer for all kinds of systems. Together with an trusted operating system, and what you see is that AFL is able to generate all kinds of random system calls. And this is basically the topic of this talk. How I created a system where I can use AFL to basically fuzz the system call layer of an operating system, which is really dense and really separated from the rest of the system, and running completely separated from the Linux environment where the AFL environment is running. So, but what I'm going to talk about is, well, what are trusted execution environments? I can imagine that for many people, this is a relatively new concept. Actually, the whole technology is something that is really coming up in the last couple of years. And then I would like to discuss, well, why is it more difficult for fuzzing a trusted execution environment than to fuzz, for example, an image parsing library. And the last part I would like to discuss is, well, how can we actually fuzz those system calls? So what is the reason why I did this? Well, trusted execution environments are rapidly rising, and actually almost every one of you will have a device that has one. So it is pretty much a mandatory technology in modern Android phones. So since Android 6, it's a mandatory component if you want to support certain features like fingerprint sensor for unlocking your device. Additionally, we start to see this type of technology also picking up in other markets, where it starts to gain traction. And this is actually a very highly privileged component inside your phone. This is actually way more privileged than, for example, the standard Android environment. The root user in Android has no way capabilities than what, for example, the trusted execution environment can do within your phone. And to have a high level of security, these type of environments are completely separated from the rest of your system. You might have heard about names like Keymaster and Gatekeeper. These are the components in Android that run on top of the trusted execution environment, and they implement, for example, the so-called hardware-backed key store. And it manages the key used for the full disk encryption of your phone, and it is containing the fingerprint data and similar kind of information. So what is the concept? Well, we have well, something we call the normal world. This is basically the standard Linux environment or Android environment everybody knows. We have applications, we have an operating system. But what we have nowadays in our systems is that we are actually having also a complete secure world or a trusted execution environment. And also there we have a complete operating system, we have applications. However, there is a reason why this system is so isolated. Often we have cryptographic keys there or other sensitive data that is being stored. And the whole idea is that even if, for example, malware compromises the Android environment, the things that are secured in the TE should still not be accessible by the malware. So those data should still be secure. There is all kinds of technology around to build trusted execution environments. For mobile devices, ARM TrustZone is by far the widest one, widely used one. Intel has something similar in the form of SGX. However, in this talk, I would like to focus on ARM TrustZone-based solutions. Others, they are very similar in the concepts, but let's not make it more complicated than needed. So, how does this actually look like? Well, of course, we have our standard Linux environment with applications. However, in the same chip, and very often, it is actually a different execution mode of your processor. We have the secure world, where we have a trusted operating systems with applications we call trusted applications or TAs. And then we have a so-called monitor that is basically orchestrating the switching between the secure world and the non-secure world. The secure world is fully isolated from the non-secure world. However, we need to be able to communicate, so we have shared memory in between. Applications in the normal world that want to communicate with the secure world are so-called client applications or CAs, and they actually invoke one of those trusted applications. So the trusted applications is basically providing services to the normal world. For example, encrypt this data with this key, or verify if this is the correct PIN code without disclosing what the actual PIN code is of the device. So what kind of TrustZone-based TE solutions are out there? Well, there are proprietary solutions, such as provided by chip manufacturers like Qualcomm, Samsung, but there are also a few open source solutions. One of them is Trusty by Google, another one is OptE, which is developed by the Linaro Consortium. And as far as I know, this is pretty much the only widely deployed open source TE solutions. And the complete source code you can find on GitHub, but what actually happens is that manufacturers are taking the source code, modifying it, implement proprietary extensions, and then ship it as part of their devices. And OptE is basically here fulfilling the role of a trusted operating system. So, what about trusted applications? Well, what you see is that the trusted applications are mostly written by the chip manufacturers or the companies that are making the devices, the OEMs. And a trusted application looks nothing like any normal world application or Linux application you have ever seen. And they make actually use of a completely different set of APIs. And there is actually a standardized API that is defined to make interoperability between different TE solutions possible. This is the Global Platform TE API. And this basically specifies how a trusted application should look like and which APIs are available across the different TE solutions. So if you want to be portable, you should make use of those. And to give you an example how that looks like, in this case, we have a trusted application implementing an AES encryption operation, and it starts with an function that is defined according to the Global Platform API specified signature that basically is invoked the moment the normal world asked the trusted the TE to perform an operation, in this case encrypting some data with a secret key stored in the TE. And actually what you see is that you have all kinds of operations like this. For example, I want to allocate an operation handle. I want to initialize the crypto subsystem. I want to populate my allocated key handle with this specific key. And as you see, this is nothing like how a normal world of application look like. We don't have a main function that is the entry point. We have a TA invoke command entry point. However, this is only the surface layer. What's actually going on is that most of those APIs are actually services that are provided by the trusted operating system. And what you see is that the API calls we have seen before are turned into system calls like allocate this crypto object, populate this crypto object with a key that is stored in this buffer, reset the state of the crypto subsystem, copy over some data, initialize, etc. And this is actually the layer we are interested in, because vulnerabilities in this layer would allow a malicious or compromised trusted application actually attack other parts of the trusted execution environment. So this is actually one of the security boundaries, again, within the trusted execution environment, we also want to be to have robust. So how does this look like in OPTE? Well, we have all kinds of system calls. We have a group of miscellaneous system calls, such as we want to log some data to the debug log, or I want to retrieve this property from the configuration or from my from the system or from the TA, such as which version of the operating system am I running. We have API calls or system calls to securely store data inside the trusted execution environment. This is basically ensuring that the data is stored, encrypted, and signed within the normal world. We have system calls providing cryptographic operations, such as symmetric, asymmetric operations, hashing operations, and all kinds of other cryptographic primitives. And we have a subsystem for supporting a so-called secure element, which is basically a separate chip to which we can communicate from the trusted execution environment, which might even have to be even more secure. In total, we have roughly 70 system calls, which is, compared to, for example, Linux, a very low amount. However, we call it a trusted execution environment. Does that also mean it's the trusted execution environment is actually secure? Basically, who guards the guardian of my chip? So, of course, we can spend a lot of effort in verifying this. However, I wanted to try something different. Can we maybe actually apply fuzzing on trusted execution environments? And there are different approaches possible, and actually colleagues of mine have already, around 2014, when the first trusted execution environments started to pop up, created a very primitive fuzzer, which back then was already quite powerful. And basically what it did, it was just throwing random data at the TE, and back then this was in some degree even enough for fuzzing the environments of those days. We could, of course, create a whole model that describes what the TE is doing and use that to, for example, replay sequences of calls. And there are actually solutions out there that are doing that. However, basically what nowadays the way to go is if we have a coverage-guided approach where we are actually learning from when we are generating new inputs based on the behavior of the system. So that when we see new behavior caused by a new generally input, we can actually use that as a starting point for generating the next input and dig deeper and deeper inside the system. So maybe we can do something with that. The idea behind it, it's already around for quite a while, but the idea is quite simple. We have a starting corpus set, which are basically our inputs. We start from fuzzing, and basically what we do is we collect one of them, or we pick one of them, we apply one or more mutations, run the target with our new input, collect which code paths have been taken due to this target, and see if we if this results in new code paths. And if it results in new code paths, we add it to our collection of inputs that we consider for generating the next input. And basically, the idea is that if we let this run over time, we will start covering more and more of the code, because from a very big brute force problem, we break it up in much smaller problems where every time we hit some new code, we actually use that as a starting point for, well, basically finding the next new piece of code. And how does and the fundamental question here is, how does the system know which part of the code we have executed or not? Here I have a part of a memcompare function, and you see the different branches and blocks, and we want to know which blocks we have executed and which blocks we have not executed due to our input. And an approach which is nowadays integrated in compilers like GCC and Clang is that we can actually add callback functions in every basic block. And we can make use of those callback functions to keep track, like, inside that callback function, we can register, well, we are called from this location in the code. Let's write this down somewhere. And at the end, we extract this information and we know which parts of the code we have executed due to this. However, what makes fuzzing operating systems difficult? Let's start with that. Well, of course, we have the problem that if you have a critical error in your operating system, you most likely bring down the whole system. While an application, you can simply restart an operating system, or you need to have something running outside it to restart it, or, this is one of the problems. Another problem is you have a lot of global state. With applications, you would like to start each of your inputs while you are fuzzing with a clean state, or at least a consistent state. In an operating system, that would mean that you have to reboot the system every time. And this can take between a few seconds to maybe up to half a minute. And this is not really something you want to have if you are fuzzing a system with a relatively high speed. Another problem is, how are you going to keep track of which part of the code you have executed and which part you have not executed? Where are you going to find a good set of seeds or corpora you can use as starting point for your fuzzing? For example, an image parser, you can just take a collection of images and you have a good starting point. For operating systems, or in this case the system call layer, our starting point is basically the execution of one or more system calls. This is not really something you can just download as some data set somewhere. And a last major problem is traceability, which basically is the concept that if you execute the same input twice, you should also have the same coverage data. The same code should be executed due to our input. However, due to threading, multi-core processing, hardware interrupts, this is actually very difficult to achieve. Because at random moments, while the operating system is running, it might actually switch to a different task, a different process, or it might actually start to handle the interrupt that is coming from the hardware. However, there are systems out there that have pretty much solved these problems. We have, of course, AFL, which is now around for 5, 6, 7 years. We have the Syscholars project by Google, which is doing an awesome job for fuzzing all kinds of operating systems nowadays. And they have pretty much solved this problem for the general purpose mainstream operating systems. So maybe we can actually leverage that for fuzzing a trusted execution environment. So, my goal, try to reuse as much as possible, because I don't want to build a new fuzzer from scratch. It's really nice to do, however, my time is limited, and this is not the problem I want to solve, at least not right now. So let's try to reuse as much as possible. Also, I am looking for good results, but not necessarily perfect results. The solution I have now, it gives useful results, but technically, it is far from perfect. So, why is fuzzing TEs then difficult? Well, it's pretty much everything that makes fuzzing operating systems difficult, but there are actually a few challenges that are unique to trusted execution environments. And one of them is, for example, that it is such an isolated environment. In principle, the normal world is only able to communicate with the trusted execution environment through the APIs that are deliberately exposed, but it's, for example, not able to access the memory of the trusted execution environment. On top of that, it's basically a second operating system running in your system, coming with all the complexities of the first operating system. And on top of that, we have a completely non-standard API, which is really specific to trusted execution environments, making the problem of finding C data to start fuzzing from even harder. You will simply not find any set of inputs or starting points you can use for fuzzing a trusted execution environment. So as you have seen, I've picked AFL, and let's take a very quick look how AFL works. Normally, we have the AFL process, and basically what it does, it runs your target application many times, each time with a different input. And what AFL gets back is basically a bitmap with information with bit parts of the code were executed due to the input. Which were executed due to the input. And this is in the form of a bitmap of, the standard size is 64 kilobytes. And basically, that looks something like this. And the meaning of this is even for AFL, if you have something marked in the bitmap, it means you have executed some place in the code. It doesn't necessarily know which part of the code, but some place. So if you see popping up new locations in the bitmap where the system indicates you have executed executed some code, that basically means you have found a new code path, even while you do not necessarily know how a location in the bitmap corresponds with a location in the actual binary. So can we then just run AFL as a trusted application? Well, as I told you, the system calls provided by OPTE are quite specific. If you want to do, for example, fork to start a new process, well, this is not implemented. If you want to use something like the execve system call in Linux to start executing a different binary, well, this is not implemented. Even the commonly used open system call is not implemented in a system call in OPTE. So you can forget it to use AFL as trusted application, or you are going to end up with basically a complete rewrite from scratch. So can we then maybe just run AFL as Linux application and still use it to fuzz our trusted execution environment? Well, it appears yes, we can. So how does it work? We are running AFL just as a normal Linux application. And actually what it does, instead of starting our target application we want to fuzz, we actually start a proxy application that is going to invoke certain system calls inside the trusted execution environment in behalf of OPTE. And basically what it does, on the TE side, we have a proxy trusted application, and basically based on the description provided by the proxy application on the Linux side, it will perform one or more system calls. Perform the system calls, and inside the TE, we keep track of which part of the code we have executed due to these system calls inside a bitmap. And basically, when the proxy application has finished executing, we copy our bitmap back to AFL, and actually AFL thinks, well, the application I'm executing is just a normal instrumented application, and I am getting back my coverage data, so AFL is completely happy with this. However, AFL is not really able to generate system calls. AFL basically performs bit and bytewise mutations on, from the perspective of AFL, pretty much random data. So how can we actually make AFL then invoke system calls? we need to find a way that this random data can actually be interpreted as system calls. And of course, again, we can rewrite the whole mutation engine and make it smart and make it system call aware. But again, this is not what my goal is of this research. So what I did is I basically created a data format that describes the behavior of system calls. So in this case, this basically turns into a malloc operation, a memcopy operation, and the invocation of a system call wrapper function. And what you will actually get when you run this blob of data with an application that interprets it and use the proxy application inside the TE to invoke the system calls, is that it will print hello nullcon on the debug console of the TE. So how does it work? Well, system calls in OpTE can take up to 8 arguments, identified by some ID, and they take pretty much everything you also see for a standard Linux system call. It can take a value, it can take a pointer, it can take a pointer to a structure containing pointers, etc. However, what you very often see, just like in a Linux system, is that often as an argument, we actually have the return value or a returned handle from a previous system call. So somehow, we need to make the system aware of those interactions. And actually, this is also by far the most difficult part. So what we basically did is I defined a data format that allows me to define this behavior and also have embedded the content of buffers embedded inside. This basically allows me to provide arbitrary data structures, strings, keys, etc. And to able to model every system call in OpTE, we have value types, we have buffer types, and so-called data types, which are pretty much buffers with data coming from the data definition file. And how it looks like on the data file format, the first 32 bits are the system call identifier. Then we have a definition for each of the arguments that will follow, where we use a nibble for each of the argument follows, which nicely fits with 8 arguments in a 32-bit integer. And then for some of the arguments, we can actually have some variable length data that will follow. For example, we can have an argument that says, well, my argument is actually describing a buffer with some inline data, or it's actually a 32-bit integer value. In this case, it's, for example, the second argument is actually 16 decimal. It's the length of the string, and the first argument is defining where we can find the data of our string within the data definition file. And this even allows us to model much more complex system calls. So in this case, we have seen the example before of performing the AES encryption within the TE. Here we have the data definition file to reproduce exactly the same system calls and end up with a successful successfully encrypting some data by replaying the system calls we have seen before. And actually, to turn this data back into system calls, we need to make the system aware of some information, such as which system calls exist, what is the identifier that corresponds to each system call, and how many arguments system calls take. And on top of that, there is some optional information I provide to the fuzzer, for which the use will come clear later. This is completely optional for the fuzzing, but it will make the fuzzing more effective. So, the nice thing of this approach is that this is basically not just allowing fuzzing system calls, we can actually use this for fuzzing everything. In this case, we are not even invoking system calls, we are just invoking the function that is going to directly set up the arguments in the correct way and then perform the system call. But we still have the problem that AFL doesn't know what a system call is, right? And we have seen very nice results where AFL was able to completely figure out data formats on its own. However, this is very computational intensive, so let's help it an end. I did make some examples by hand. So for example, the AES example, I set all the bits correctly by hand. This is very tedious. I don't want to do this for 70 system calls and many more different scenarios we can actually execute with the system calls. We would like to have a starting set that pretty much cover the whole system call interface, or at least as much as possible. So AFL has a test suite. Can we maybe make somehow use of the test suite of AFL? And basically, the test suite contains thousands of regression tests, compatibility tests to see if it really adheres to the specification. And the nice thing is this covers pretty much every part of the system call interface. So what we do is we are going to convert each of the test cases into an input corpus for AFL. And the way it works is we have the XTest application running on in the normal world, and there are a whole bunch of test applications running within OptiE. And the test application is going to invoke that the test application in the normal world is going to execute commands on the test applications in the secure world, and basically those test applications will then make certain system calls. And this which system calls are involved is exactly what we are interested in. So what I did is I created a system that basically starts logging which system calls are executed by the test applications due to the test cases that are performed. And this log is then, when the test case is finished, transformed in the data format, copied back to the normal world by the library that is used for communicating from the normal world with the secure world, and then basically stored on disk in the data format we have seen earlier. And this is exactly why we have this optional information that describes the behavior of the system calls. Because this information that, for example, says the first argument is an input buffer, and in the second argument you are going to find the length, we can actually capture all the information, all the buffers, and put it into the data format we have seen. Or this system call is going to return a handle you should use later on as part of the cryptostate alloc system call. And actually what you see is that when we actually print this information, we can actually augment our output already with, well, the address you have here is actually a pointer of a certain length. And so, pointer is actually a pointer to a structure which contains more pointers to data. And this is based on this information. And due to that, we can actually convert it back or convert it in the data format. However, one of the tricky parts is that somehow we need to know that the address we provide here will contain, after the system call, the handle we should provide to the next system call. So somehow we need to model that. And the way we model that is that we are not modeling or capturing these exact values. We capture the behavior and say, well, for that argument, you should allocate a new buffer. And for the next system call you are going to invoke, you are going to dereference a 32-bit value from that pointer. This is what I would like to show now. Okay. So here I have, on the top, I have my Linux normal world environment, and I have an application called Hello World. And basically, this is doing the AES operation we have seen before. We have some key, some plain text, and basically it will transfer this information to the TE. And on the TE side, we are now doing the actual encryption, and it will return a ciphertext. And when we look at the output of the TE, we actually see at the bottom that we have actually started the trusted application and executed it. So if we go back to the top, we define an environment variable which is picked up by the normal world library used for communication with the trusted execution environment. And basically what we say is, when you are executing this application and it is going to make calls to the TE, put in this slash temp folder trace files of the trusted execution environment sessions you have observed. So in this case, we do again our AES encryption, and you see now a new line at the bottom. This is due to the normal world library seeing, well, you want to trace what happened. And on the TE side, we suddenly see a whole lot more output. We see all the system calls that are being performed together with information with what the system thinks, what kind of argument it is. For example, in this case, the first value is apparently dereference from a pointer we have seen earlier. So we need to match it with the content of the allocated or from the output arguments we have seen earlier. The second argument, oh, that's apparently a pointer to data. So we need to capture the content of that buffer and put it in our file. Oh, apparently the third argument is a 32-bit integer. In this case, it describes the length of our buffer, etc. And when we now go to our trace file, we see that it has automatically captured everything. We can actually visualize the operations that are described by this file. So this is these are the calls that are going to be executed when we are going to replay this file. And we can then actually use another utility to actually replay the system calls. And now you actually see at the bottom that on the debug console from the TE that it has actually executed the system calls, and in such a way that we actually have the same result. All of them are successful, and we end with well, a zero, which means success. And we can actually do the very same with the test suite of OPTE. You see that it starts executing all kinds of system calls, and you can also see that it prints like, oh, after this session, I have put the definition of the test case that I just executed in the trace file. So, is it that simple? Well, in reality, you will actually encounter... there is one main problem you will encounter. If we just run those test cases, what we will see is that we will actually get different bitmap outputs. So AFL will start to get confused and think that it has found new code paths, but in reality you are just executing the same code path over and over again. However, there are things running next to the test case you are running in the operating system that make it switch to, for example, a different thread or a hardware interrupt, or it is doing an RPC call back into the normal world. So we need to actually not just capture the trace information inside the system, but we actually need to capture somehow split this data between everything that is going on in the system. So instead of just keeping track of which code paths are taking globally of the system, we actually are basically putting this, we need to separate this data on a session level within the TE. For what you should know is that for every trusted application, we can open one or more sessions, and each session is represented inside the system in this structure. That also makes that this is a very good candidate to keep track of which code paths are executed by this session, because that's exactly the information we are interested in. So we actually make this data part of the session information. And basically what it keeps track of is this, is according the standard way the AFL instrumentation works, we have a bitmap of a certain size. We mix in the previous location we have seen together with if we want to trace or not. However, if we just do this, our system will become awfully slow. The problem is that looking up this structure every time we are performing or for every basic block executed within the system, this is not very efficient. So we actually also need to somehow buffer or somehow cache where the context is actually stored at that moment in time in memory for this specific session we are executing. And for that, I have actually changed the system of how OptiE works, and actually for that I'm using one of the core specific thread registers that are available in modern ARM cores. So actually the threading mechanism within OptiE is enhanced such that it will actually resolve the correct context pointer as part of the switching between the threads in the operating system. So if you let this run for a while, and who knows what happens now, it's still running, you will actually start to find certain issues. And while OptiE in general is a good, robust system, like any software that's out there, it is not bug-free. And recently, we have actually shared some of the issues we have found in OptiE to Linaro, and this resulted in some patches in the most recent version, and there is one of them I would like to discuss with you, because it is very a very good example of the type of issues you find with fuzzing, while otherwise they might be not that obvious. So we have our system call, our wrapper function, which will do the SVC instruction to switch to the kernel, and basically the kernel will do some magic and eventually call the syscall lock function with exactly the same arguments we have put here. And that code will look something like this. We have our buff and our length. We make a new buffer inside the operating system and copy over the data, which we then print to the debug output. And the idea is that the pointers you are provide, they should not point within the TE operating system itself. So as long as things point to trusted application memory, everything is fine. But the moment things point to operating system level memory, you want to forbid this, because this could leak information from the operating system or from other applications. Or in the case you are writing to the address that is provided, this would compromise the operating system. So the function, the copy from user function, will actually call another internal function that is going to check the permission attributes for the memory pages. And in this case, we are just asking for read permissions to that piece of memory. And do we actually have read permissions? And inside our check function, what we actually see what it actually does is it takes the address and the length plus what kind of checks you want to perform. And then it will create a loop, and it will divide the buffer up in the individual memory pages and do a call into the MMU subsystem to retrieve the attributes that correspond with those memory pages. And there is actually something going wrong here with the checking of those attributes. So this is the loop that is actually being performed. And basically what it does, it starts at the buffer address that is provided. It will loop, it will increment with the size of a page, of a memory page. Nowadays, this is in most platforms supported by OptiE 4 kilobytes. Back in the days, it was using pages of 1 megabyte. And it will loop until the condition address plus length is satisfied. And if we look which memory pages are checked, we see that there is actually a fundamental problem here. So let's say we provide a pointer bit in a random memory page. And we have a length such that it spans at least 2 memory pages. And it also works with 3 or more memory pages. It's important here that the pointer we provide is not page aligned, because what will happen is that due to how the loop condition is constructed, we will correctly check the first memory page, or actually every memory page, but not the last memory page. We will actually never check if we have access or correct access to that memory page. So this is one of the issues you can find with the fuzzer. This was recently fixed in the most recent version. However, it's all nice, but we would like to know, of course, which parts of the system did we fuzz, or how much coverage did we get in the system? Can we somehow keep track of this information and maybe even visualize it? Of course, we know this information already on the level of individual input. So maybe we should just aggregate that information and visualize it. And there is a very nice plugin for IDA Pro, the disassembler, which basically allows you to do this based on a certain data format that describes which parts of the code are being executed. And what you then can do is I've created a script that collects the system is not just collecting the coverage information now on an input level, but I've added a second bitmap that tracks it on a global level, so for all the inputs so far, and it is dumping that also as to a file on the disk as well. And basically what it means here is every bit in this big map is basically corresponding with an address in the binary. And we can actually convert this very easily, this bitmap, to the data format that is supported by the Lighthouse plugin. And what we then can do is let's try it again. So here I have the TE binary of the operating systems. So we have all the system calls as functions. And actually, we can now load our coverage file. It is not completely happy for some reason. And we see that, we have the fuzzer I just showed you at the beginning. It had a good set of starting points, and we have actually covered already quite a bit of the code. So, for example, if I pick, for example, this function related to the storage subsystem within OptiE, all the blue blocks are basically the blocks of the code we have executed due to the fuzzer. And basically, this way we can see, well, these are the places where the fuzzer is stuck, and these are the places we have successfully tested this way. Or, for example, this system call, which is freeing some enumerator. It hasn't done that much in this function. Basically we can see which part we did already fuzz and which parts we didn't fuzz yet. So, where are we? Basically, the fuzzer is working. It is giving results. However, there are still some problems I'm working on. So, for example, the separation between all the threads within the system and the threads from the interrupts is it remains problematic. So sometimes the system crashes due to it after a few hours. So with a script that automatically restarts it and resumes it, that is how I overcome it now. There is also a property in of the system. I cannot fully correctly model it if you are loading many properties in the crypto system at once. And I am currently working on making this a more generalized framework. So recently I started to think, why should I keep this limited to system calls? Basically, the whole system has nothing to do with system calls anymore. Basically, it allows you to model data and arguments for any function you want to call. Which would make it even more powerful and not just limited for fuzzing, for example, this system. The primary patches and the code of the proxy applications will become available soon, maybe today, otherwise somewhere in the coming days. And also, Linaro has already showed interest if this should maybe be, or parts of it should be integrated upstream as well. And with that, I would like to conclude my talk. And maybe you have questions. Yes, please.
I just ask you. So, how are you instrumenting the OptiE? I have a bunch of questions actually.
So okay. Is it maybe? So, how do I instrument OptiE? Basically, I leverage here what is already available nowadays. In the modern GCC compilers and Clang, I can enable the adding of those callback functions with just a single compile time flag. And OptiE, you can just normally compile with a modern ARM cross-compiler. So what I basically do is I provide that flag. It will generate callbacks in every basic block of the code. And then I have a custom implementation of the callback function that behaviorally is completely the same as what normally AFL puts into the binary, except in this case, it is customized to make it work in the OptiE environment.
Got it. So you mentioned that AFL detects every iteration as a new path.
Every what?
All of the iterations are detected as a new path, which is inaccurate by AFL when you're fuzzing the OptiE.
Yeah.
Yeah. So AFL uses its mutation engine depending on the number of paths it's finding and what bit flip causes a new path to be found. So that would essentially break the mutation engine. So how are you dealing with that?
I cannot notice that I have broken the mutation engine. It works perfectly fine.
Well, the detection of new paths would not be as effective, right?
It might be less effective. Yeah. But yeah, it works perfectly fine.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure it works. Okay. So you mentioned that you're using syscalls, like the Opti-related syscalls to fuzz the operations. So I'm not very familiar with Opti, but I've worked on SGX a bit. Mm-hmm. And I know that it exposes some APIs, some O calls and P calls for data sealing and unseal operations or data store operations, vault unseal operations. So how does, how is this fuzzing approach different from fuzzing, say, Enclave APIs or TE APIs?
I would say that, of course, you need to integrate some of the specific of SGX, and I'm not really too familiar with SGX, the internals. I know the high level on the architecture, how it works, but I am not knowing it on the API level. Well, I completely bypass it and directly go to the system call layer, where I use the wrapper functions, which basically wrap the SVC instruction, but it's not providing anything else. I can easily just say, let's go one layer higher. And instead of defining system calls, I define just arbitrary API functions, and it will also work.
What's the downside of that?
That I am executing way more code, and I'm not that much interested in issues in the API layer, which is embedded in the trusted application, that I was really interested here in the issues that are in on the operating system level. And that has a background in the work we are doing.
Okay. And when you're fuzzing syscalls, the threading is definitely going to cause an issue when you're triaging the crashes. Or do you get core dumps from the crashes over here? What are the crashes that you're getting?
So debugging trusted execution environments is sometimes challenging.
It's always challenging.
Yes. So a lot of the debugging involves printf. In this case, what you saw is that it is running in QEMU, so I can attach a debugger to the trusted execution environment as well. On the other side, I know Opti, the source code, by now pretty much inside out. So I quickly knows where I should look. So usually I just go with a few printfs and I can come very far.
Thanks.
Any more doubts, guys?